Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard their point. Now, hear the counterpoint on Libertarian Counterpoint Podcasts.
Good afternoon and welcome to Libertarian Counterpoint. We're coming at you on July 24th. Still lots of, well, occasional rioting and protesting going on in parts of the country. We're back in the heart of lockdown mode in a lot of places in the country as well. We're going to discuss a little bit of that and some other topics as we go into the show. But let me introduce you to our panelists. Up in our left-hand corner, we have Leon, the word Brathwaite, last word in liberty. And up in our right, oh, and he's a retired engineer from the state of California. And up in the right-hand corner, we have Tim Everett, our screaming eagle of freedom. He is a pilot in the state of California as well. And my name is Jason McPhee, and I'll be your host today. One thing I wanted to also let you know, we have a website too that you can, and an email that you can send comments to. So if you have any comments during the show and you send them there, we'll try and address them in a bonus section if we can. Also, if you have any kind of experience with a job shutdown or a business shutdown due to either the riots or the lockdowns, with COVID lockdowns, we'd like to hear about that as well. And if you send us some information on that, maybe we could even have you on the show at some point. Let's get into the heart of the show here. So recently, one of the things that spurred some of the riots that we had was a case of a police shooting in Atlanta that happened a few weeks ago now, I believe it was, where a gentleman went to sleep in his car in a Wendy's drive-thru, and he was, you know, the police came over. Everything looked like it was going well. Then, as it looked like he was going to be arrested for a DUI, he bolted, resisted arrest, and got shot. But we didn't want to get into all the specifics of that necessarily, but what we wanted to talk about is some updates with the district attorney on that case. And so one of the things that has happened in that case, the officer has been charged with homicide, and he is one of the developments was that there was a grand jury a subpoena for documents. Well, apparently the grand jury is not actually being seated because of the COVID lockdowns, and that makes it, I believe, illegal for him to be requesting this through a grand jury subpoena, and yet his office was still requesting the information. And that's actually the type of thing that could potentially get the case maybe thrown out later on. So this is just one of those things where, you know, you have a DA who's also being investigated for some other issues of misconduct as well. But the idea that, you know, here our government official might cause a lot more chaos in this case, regardless of what, you know, what you think about the case itself. You know, the government may wind up exacerbating the case if this gets thrown out on some kind of a, you know, technicality. Did either of you guys want to jump in on that? I know, Leon, you were pretty interested in this topic.
Well, the thing is here is it's not only that the district attorney was requesting documents related to this case. He was claiming in a legal document that this was a grand jury subpoena for the documents that he wanted. As it turned out, the grand jury was already suspended since March 13th, I believe, is the date, if I saw the information correctly. And then he took this information under the false pretense of a grand jury subpoena. Now, in most states of the union, I don't know specifically in Georgia, but I would bet you, that is illegal. This man may be in legal jeopardy. Now, this complicates the case itself, because here comes a judge. He looks at this. What is he going to do? He could throw the case out. Or even if it did go to trial, it could end up being a mistrial. And what's going to happen on the streets? Nobody's going to look at the facts of the case. Nobody's going to look at what Paul Howard did, which was probably illegal. Nobody's going to do that. But everybody's going to start rioting, saying, oh, there we go again.
And just to clarify too, Paul Howard is the DA in the case. I just wanted to jump
right.
In
yes, Paul Howard there. is the district attorney in Fulton County. So everybody's gonna say, here we go again. White guys shoot black guy, and worse yet, he shoot black guy in the back without looking at the facts of the case. And here we go again. The justice system is gonna let them go without looking at what Paul Howard did, who's already under investigation for another piece of shadiness he did concerning his salary. This is unbelievable.
Tim, did you have any thoughts?
they may have backtracked on whether they even should have charged the officer with murder or homicide or whatever they're charging him with. And decided, you know, maybe we ought to just save face and do something that would cause the case to be thrown out on purpose to throw it out. But that's just conjecture on my part. Absolutely. I mean, knowing how protected police are for their actions. And even though in this case, I mean, in this particular case, I kind of think that Leon brings up, you know, it'll never be investigated, you know. So we won't know if it doesn't go to trial. And if that's the situation, then we'll never really know. But it appears to my, you know, I wasn't there, I don't know, but it appears like there may have been justifiable homicide in this case. Don't know, but could be. So it could be they went and looked at everything and talked to everybody and decided, you know, let's just get out of here with, you know, saving face or something. I don't know. Even though Leon's probably right too. People will see through that and go, here's another white guy shooting a black guy in the back and he gets away with it, you know, and like, what's going on?
There's some real political issues going on here that is influencing the actions in this case. Number one, that Paul Howard, he ran in a primary, he came second. So and the person who beat him, also a Democrat, is favored to win in the general win, or he's supposed to have a runoff or some kind of stuff like that. But whatever the case is, he's running from behind. Number one. Number two, the two police officers who tried to arrest Rayshard Brooks, they did it, I think it was on a Friday night. By the next week, this man was already charging the officers. So where was the investigation? Where was the investigation of what was, obviously, it was a bad situation. Please look at the facts of the case. Investigate it. Fine. No, nobody's arguing against that. But where was the investigation that you think that in a matter of days you could charge two police officers for doing something which is part of their job? Now, we don't know if what they did was justifiable. We're not claiming that yet. But they were doing their job. They were trying to arrest somebody, and the guy resisted arrest and ended up assaulting the officer, stealing the taser, and running off with it and firing it, as a matter of fact. So there are a lot of political influences involving this thing, and that guy is under investigation for something else that's not related with this particular case.
Well, and the DA's actions aren't just all over the map in terms of what you've mentioned, but even in this case, prior to the case, a few weeks before it, he had been at a speech, and the question came up whether or not the cop was justified in pulling the trigger, whether or not he was in a life-threatening situation. And, a few weeks before, the DA had been in another case or another presentation in which he was saying that a taser is a lethal weapon. And then in this case, he immediately tried to say, well, there was no lethal situation. Even though he was shot, the suspect was shot literally just after firing the taser at the cop, the taser that he had taken off of the cop in a scuffle.
Yes. and this is the ridiculousness of this thing, because you're absolutely correct. He said under Georgia law, a taser is a deadly weapon, and the taser was fired just prior to him being shot. So what did he expect? I mean, this is so crazy. I don't even get Yeah. I know, but it's political. There's a lot of political stuff going on here.
But I think one of the real things to just to be concerned about, if you're, you know, just a member of the public, is that these types of things are leading to terrible riots. I mean, this particular incident in Atlanta led to some rioting. It led to the Wendy's being burned down. And then not very long after that, a crowd of rioters or protesters, whatever you want to call them, I suppose CNN would call them peaceful protesters, shot a baby in a car that was trying to pass that way. And it was a, unfortunately, I'm not sure if it's a girl or a boy, but essentially, I think it was just a kid was a couple years old, yes. I believe, is shot, you know, and it was a person of color too, you know, and their kid was killed driving through that area because these protesters were angry. And tragic. So I mean, and we're just getting over that. And now if this thing gets thrown out on technicalities, you know, you got to wonder, you know, what kind of chaos you're going to have.
It will not be nice. I can tell you that it will not be nice, because you're going to hear the same stereotype: white guys shoot black guy in the back. Oh my goodness gracious! Here we go again, racism in America. That's what we're going to hear. And somebody else's business is going to get burned down, and somebody else is going to be rioting, and somebody else is probably going to get killed because Paul Howard acted like, well, I better not say the word. We're being recorded. Acted inappropriately in trying to prosecute this case. Let me just put it that way.
But and you got to be really careful about what you take. Now, this is a public employee. And speaking of public employees, we have public employee unions who will step in and defend them if issues come up that are bad. And one of the topics we wanted to get into was public employee unions today. And their impact on society. And certainly the issue has come up lately with police unions and the issue of qualified immunity. Another way that, you know, public employee unions might be coming up as well is that a lot of municipalities are right now underwater in terms of their tax bases and revenues they're collecting, and a lot of public employees you know, get fairly decent salaries. So this is a kind of a catastrophe that we're in. We just don't know it yet, I think. And public employee union and unions are a key player in that. So you know, I just wanted to, you know, throw this out there to you guys. Do you guys have any thoughts on you know, some of the issues with public employee unions that we're dealing with right now?
Well, if Leon's not going to jump right in, yeah, I guess I'll. I see two. You mentioned two things, and I think there are two separate issues here. One being the police unions, and the other being the qualified immunity. Statutes that actually came from the Supreme Court. They were birthed in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court has decided not to unbirth them, not to abort them, so to speak. And it's plain that they are not ever in a bazillion years going to touch qualified immunity. The scuttlebutt in all the sources that I've been listening to about qualified immunity is that now it's just going to be up to the legislature, federally, to either get rid of it or to just give their wonderful blessing upon it forevermore. And there's been legislation that's been introduced, and it hasn't gone anywhere, and so on. But you know, this is our only hope to really do, in my opinion, to pick the low hanging fruit of solving this dilemma of police doing things and getting away with it, which I believe to be qualified immunity is one of the low hanging fruit. Separate fruit, also low hanging, is the police unions, and they have gotten complete, you know, just police fire, and all the city county employee unions have gone, you know, just so crazy with all this stuff. And it's even though it goes kind of unknown, but it's the book Plunder came out in 2009, and it illustrated this issue, you know, way back then. Now here we are, 2020, 11 years later, and still the same thing, and nothing's been done, nothing's going to be done, and I don't know if anything will be done, but these are the two issues that if you really want to improve the way that police interact, and there's always going to be issues. I mean, you know, we're all just humans, so there's always going to be issues, but I think getting rid of qualified immunity for police and having them do something like malpractice insurance for police, that similar to what doctors do, and you know they somehow survive, and I know they different salaries and so on involved, but you know it would all be, you know, if an actuarial accounting would see that, gosh, we can't insure these police because there's so many of them killing people, and maybe we'll get at the beginning of solving that problem. That problem. And so, and then police union, same thing. To get it to where you can actually fire a cop. I mean, you know, I could be fired real easy if I do any little thing as a pilot that would endanger people. They would fire me no problem whatsoever. Okay. Sure. So sure. How come? Why? What's special about them, you know, that makes it, you know, most police go through their entire career, they don't even pull the gun out of the holster, vast
right.
majority.
Right.
And so right. don't tell me, you know. On the other hand, I am quite dependent upon a single engine turning its propeller while I'm over mountainous terrain with no place to go, really. And, you know, so if that engine quits on me, I'm in a heap of trouble. Okay. And I'm in, exposed to this every day I fly. So, you know, don't bellyache about, you know, the fact that you're in a dangerous occupation. You know, I personally just don't care.
And Tim, that to make it clear, too, it's not just police, but I mean, we're talking about public employees in general, too.
Right.
I mean, this is going to be a problem.
Yeah, fire departments, everybody.
Yeah.
I mean, the there are four groups of people. I think I mentioned this before. There are four groups of people that they have that where these public employee unions are protecting. It's the civil servants, and full disclosure, I was one, and Jason is one also.
You're at me out.
I'm in private industry.
Yes. Separate yourself right now from us, please. we have civil servants, we have the police, fire, and teachers. These are the four groups of people in America that have become almost untouchable. And they are having horrendous impact upon society. Some of these cities, like Stockton, for instance, are going bankrupt, in part because of the unfunded liabilities from the pension plans and the health benefits that are given after people retire and that kind of, well, even while they're working, some of these things are problematic. These unions end up protecting the worst of the worst. Look, like in New York City right now, we have this thing they call the rubber room. That's where they send teachers. And some of these teachers are accused of statutory rape, okay? Statutory rape or even sexual assault. The case that Jason sent out here that we were using in preparation for this show. This guy had been in the rubber room for like 20 years and we're still paying him. He made $132,000 last year in salary. And we still, I think it's a him, still paying him. And this is going on. I had somebody, I went to school, the equivalent of elementary school in Trinidad. I went to school with him. He was accused of statutory rape. A 14-year-old girl. He was teaching in the New York public schools. He went to that rubber room for almost 2 years, but he did end up in prison. Thank God, he ended up in prison. But it was in that rubber room for 2 years, full salary, full benefits. This thing is bankrupting us.
Leon, when he went to prison, did he get safety pay added on to his?
I don't know. This happened about 5 years ago. So I don't know if he's back out. I don't know. I'm not in contact with this person, but I know he is. I went to school with him.
Just in the point of safety pay, that's something where, like, if you have a normal job and you wind up going into the prison and you're a state employee, you wind up getting an extra bonus added onto your paycheck. It's like an extra 2 or 3% exactly, bump, yes, or something like that. I don't know. But anyways, at least that's the way it works in California. But, you know, there is a overall point about unions, too, as far as libertarians are concerned. So for the most part, the position about unions for libertarians is that in general, there's nothing wrong with a bunch of people getting together and voicing their desire to either work together or quit in unity. That's just freedom of speech, freedom of association. I think where it gets a little more tricky for libertarians, where we tend to get our hackles up a little more, is when they try to get special laws that allow them extra privileges, maybe the ability to shut a business down if they're not, you know, negotiating properly, or potentially block them from hiring other people to replace them. That would be interfering with freedom of association. But there's a trickier part here for public employee unions, because in the case of a normal union, you have people with incentive on one side to protect their interest, and the owner of the business and the people who are investing in that business, and people who are the employees on the other side. And so you got both sides really represented. But in case of public employee unions, it's a little bit different, where the person who's supposed to be representing the taxpayers, who are kind of like the owners, I guess you'd say, they don't have quite the same incentives to protect the pocketbook as a business owner might. And in fact, the public employee union is often a big constituent for some of these people who are negotiating with them. So it's almost like the fox is in charge of the hen house, you might say.
In most cases, I'm sorry, did I cut you off, Jason?
No. I was getting ready to throw it out to you.
Most cases, what happened, these public employee unions give 99% of their money to the Democrats. I mean, I hate to be hopping on this point, but it is true. They give 99% of their money to the Democrats, help them get elected, and then when time to negotiate the next contract, who do you think they're negotiating with? The very same people that just get elected. So these people who are supposed to be representing us is giving away the farm to these public employee unions after the public employee unions help them get elected. This is the corruption that's going on out there. Now, I don't have a problem with unions at all, whether it's in the public space or in the private space. I don't have a problem with unions. Well, the public space, I may have a little problem. There's some issues here that we really should talk about. But I don't have a problem with unions. What I have a problem with is when these unions, according to, you talk about special laws, Jason, when these unions are allowed to take money from me when I never request their service. And I did that for 28 and a half years until the Janus decision. And I think that's a violation of my rights. And this is horrible.
I think also, too, you can see the impact over time in this. I looked at some statistics about 4 or 5 years ago from Bureau of Labor Statistics. And it's actually, people used to talk about the point of going into civil service years ago was because you have more security, but you're going to get paid a little bit less, was sort of the idea. But it's actually now, if you look at Bureau of Labor Statistics, people who work for civil service are actually doing a little bit better than people in the private sector, and they have more job security, which kind of shows you where that imbalance is, with the unions and such. But Tim, did you have any?
Not only more security, but also better benefits also.
Yeah. Tim, do you want to jump in on this before we get to our final stuff?
Yeah, I think it was, and Leon or Jason, you may know exactly for sure, but I thought it was Roosevelt that wrote a letter of a warning about public employee unions back.
Yes, it was FDR. It was FDR, yes.
FDR, okay, then. Yeah, that, if you read that letter, it's like, very prescient about what was going to happen and what ended up actually happening. So it was.
Sorry about that. I accidentally.
Did the
well, we have a. Yeah, finish your thought and we'll get into our knucklehead noise.
No, that's it. Yeah, there it is.
Sorry, all we're right, playing with the sound let's effect here and it went off prematurely.
Control yourself.
That's right.
You're excited here. Let's do it again.
we gotta have to talk to this host.
Oh, there we go. There we go. Yeah, let's do it one more time.
you gotta make a rev, though. Rev.
We'll have to play with that a little bit. But anyway, this is our Knucklehead Noise Patrol. Near the end of the show, we like to get into something kind of ridiculous or silly that some public person has said that, you know, ends it on kind of either a funny or disgusted note. Usually we wind up laughing at the end. but anyway, bringing it back to sort of corrupt DAs, in St. Louis, we've got this case of these two people who were brandishing guns. It's kind of iconic now, the guy in the pink polo shirt and his wife pointing a gun at a crowd of peaceful protesters is what CNN called them. Anyway, the issue was they were trespassing the protesters. They came onto their property, now the DA has charged the two people who brought guns out to protect their property with a crime. And specifically what she said is peaceful protesters, there it again, peaceful protesters were met by guns and a violent assault. We must protect the right to peacefully protest, and any attempt to chill it through intimidation or threat of deadly force will not be tolerated. So they're being charged and had their guns taken away, and the people who are actually trespassing and kind of intimidating the homeowners were, there's no charges there at all. In fact, the same DA has been releasing people who have been caught shoplifting in the riots and the protests. Yes. So, you know, that's her idea of peaceful protest. But do you guys have any thoughts on this?
You know, this woman is out of her mind, okay? I'm sorry. She's out of her mind. These people were on private property. They broke down the gate, okay? So they broke down the gate. They vandalized the gate. None of these people are being charged. But the people who were protecting their lives and protecting their property, these people were somehow criminals. Could you imagine this? We have gone upside down in this country where criminals are becoming good people and good people are becoming criminals. This is what is happening. These people, I mean, the governor of Missouri said if they're convicted, he will pardon them. And that's good. But these people should not be charged in the first case. Everybody has a right to protect their own property. I have a right. And you guys have a right to do this. And this DA is out of her mind. I'm sorry. I
Woo, almost got out.
Don't want to scare away our half of our audience.
You mean the other two people, right?
Hey, who knows? You might get charged by that DA.
Yeah, that's right. Yes.
George Orwell was right when Leon said, you know, good people are bad, bad people are good. George Orwell, he scored. Everything's coming out exactly, just a little late, that's all.
Yeah, yes. We recommend, in addition to checking out our show on Facebook, we recommend checking out 1984 as well. And George Orwell. Yeah. It's definitely a
pretty book, much what's happening.
We've reached the end of our show. We don't have any comments, so we won't be going into a bonus section. But if you liked our show, leave any comments or contact us if you have any things you want us to discuss. You can find more of our shows on Facebook, Libertarian Counterpoint, and we'll see you next time. Thanks so much for joining us.